Liberty, welcome to Church Online.
Welcome to JHM.
And welcome to HSM.
It is so great to be with you guys today. We love you so much, we could not let a week go by and not hang out with you or worship together with you.
That's right. Now, we might not physically be together, but we're gathered together virtually, and we're grateful that you chose to join us.
And this week, we are gonna worship together. We're gonna hear an encouraging message from God's Word as we continue our Door series. We're gonna have a little fun. We're gonna pray together. We're gonna have a good time. It's gonna be great.
Right. It's gonna be awesome. Oh, Katie, we're not supposed to touch and high five. Hook me up with some of that.
I got it.
Here's the deal, you guys. May or may not know, but apparently there are people who are like touching things and each other and then licking their hands and touching their eyeballs and stuff. Instead, we're here to encourage you to go with the old elbow touch. It looks like
this. It's like an elbow high five.
Just do that, because I don't know if you know this or not.
You can't lick your elbow.
It's impossible.
Can't
look at
it.
Check this out. I'm trying as hard as I can. Try it yourself at home. It's impossible.
It's impossible.
Stick with the elbow touch. It's much safer.
Yeah, it's important because we're in a time, right? We're in a season where things are a little bit unique.
Yeah.
And maybe one of those unique things that you've experienced is you've gone to the grocery store or Target and you've noticed certain aisles have empty shelves.
That's right.
Things that are not a luxury, but are actually a necessity.
Like this. $100 a roll.
Toilet paper. It is definitely a necessity, but it seems as if we're running out.
Yeah. So, we're here to help you out. It's better to plan ahead and to be prepared. So we're here to help you out with that. We've got a little segment that we like to call
Will It Wipe. All right, picture this. So you walk into your bathroom, there's two sheets left on the roll, and there's no other toilet paper in the house. You need to be ready to roll with some alternatives in case there is no toilet paper.
Yeah, and that tube's not gonna do much to help.
It's not good, it's not good. So my first suggestion would be wrapping paper. So I don't know about you, but at my house I have a ton of Christmas wrapping paper left over or birthday wrapping paper. Put some rolls of wrapping paper into your bathrooms and, you know, use that. I mean, it's a lot more festive than regular toilet paper.
Just one caution, watch out for paper cuts.
Paper cuts.
Be gentle.
It's a thing.
That's all
it's
I'm
real.
Saying.
Yeah.
Now, my first suggestion would be to head into your brother or your sister's room because there's an item in there that feels like a luxury in times like these. Grab their pillowcase, cut it up into some pieces, and everybody wins.
They don't need it.
Yeah.
It's totally fine.
Yep.
My next suggestion would be shower curtain. It's totally convenient.
The toilet
is right there, the shower curtain's right there. Just use it, rinse it, and then use it again.
Yeah.
It's so easy.
Now, I've noticed a lot of junior high and high school students who have holy socks. And maybe now is the perfect time to get some new socks and use those old holy ones.
It's so
very convenient.
It's so easy.
Yeah.
I would suggest maybe heading into the kitchen and grabbing a couple of kitchen sponges. Bring those into the bathroom. They're really absorbent. You can reuse them. Feels like a good option.
And I can tell you from experience, avoid the green scratchy stuff.
Soft side only, obviously.
Now, there's another suggestion I have for you that is, it seems like we're not gonna be using our textbooks much in the future. So grab your textbook, rip a page out, put that to good use because feels wise.
Stack them up in your bathroom.
Yeah.
I have a last option. It's kind of a fresher option, dryer sheets. Those are not flying off the shelves. There's plenty of them and they smell so good.
That will definitely change the aroma of the bathroom.
It'll change
all the good ways.
Totally.
Yeah.
All right, now, I know we're making light of kind of a tense and tough time. I know there's a lot of fear and anxiety that's real in kind of the season that we're in, but we want you to know that it's okay for us to come together, it's okay for us to laugh and have fun and worship together in this kind of crazy time.
Yeah, the Bible says in Psalm 118, verse 24, that this is the day the Lord has made, so let us rejoice and be glad in it. That even in times like these that seem a little bit crazy or chaotic, maybe people are a little bit fearful or panicked, that we can choose to be joyful. And so our encouragement to you would be, man, cling to the hope of Jesus, be joy-filled and joyful, look for ways to love and serve those around you.
All right, so sit back, relax, and let's be encouraged from God's word together.
It's been a rough morning for me, you know how that is, and I have absolutely nothing to wear, so black zippy for me. Up, everyone, it's 7 in the morning, and it's gonna be a good day, so yellow zippy, here I come. Just got my Starbucks. Oh, what the? First they got my order wrong, then they got my name wrong, and now I'm gonna have the worst day ever. So the people have spoken. Yay! Got my coffee. Oh, that's not right. Decided that I'm gonna keep the drink. It's actually pretty good. My mom taught me that a little napkin and water can solve anything. Mom just said she's gonna be late, so guess I'm waiting like a loser today. Thanks, Debbie.
Hello, darkness, my old friend.
Just got a text from my mom that she's gonna be late for picking me up, but I decided that I'm just gonna walk home instead because it's a beautiful day. So here we go. It's 10 p.m. Didn't get my coffee in the morning. Spilled fries on my favorite pants. And I lost a bunch of followers. It was a pit. Today I had some bad stuff, but there was some good stuff too, so thank you for following along. Today was a good day.
My name is Jason, and welcome to week 3 of our Door series. I want to introduce you to a word that most of you have heard, but may not know what it really means. So I thought we'd dive deeper today on this word called contentment. I feel like in today's culture, contentment is sort of a lost art, and here's why. Contentment can be defined as having a peace of mind, a state of mental or emotional satisfaction, or happiness. Contentment isn't necessarily an overly excited kind of happy, but rather a quiet confidence that God is at work even when we can't sense it. Now, the Apostle Paul, one of the writers of the New Testament, he talks a little bit about contentment in his letters to the Philippians, the church in Philippi. In Philippians chapter 4, verses 11 to 13, Paul writes this, "Not that I was ever in need, for I have learned how to be content with whatever I have. I know how to live on almost nothing or with everything. I've learned the secret of living in every situation, whether it is with a full stomach or empty, with plenty or little. For I can do everything through Christ who gives me strength." Paul says he's learned how to be content with whatever he has, whatever situation he's in, whatever circumstance he finds himself in. He knows how to be content. Now, this might not seem like a big deal to you. It's like, bro, you wrote half the New Testament. You're very righteous. You're very close to the Lord. We get it. You got favor in the eyes of God. Good for you. But Paul was actually in prison when he wrote this, letter to the church. And he was put in prison because of his faith in Christ and because he was preaching the gospel, which was and still is illegal in many places. See, it's one thing to be content when everything is going right, but true contentment is really tested when things aren't really going right. They aren't too peachy. They're actually quite frustrating. Paul writes about having a thorn in his flesh. And most scholars believe that this was a physical struggle. Maybe he had a limp or he had this physical handicap in some way. At one point in his life, he was in a brutal shipwreck, almost cost him his life. Another time, he got bit by a poisonous snake. Homie's out here thinking he's Crocodile Dundee. Dude was in prison multiple times in his life, all because of his faith. And he still says that he has learned to be content through it all. See, his problems might be big, but he knew the grace of God is greater still. And that was his contentment. We don't live in a very content world. Most of us are striving to get more, and we're often going for bigger and better. What's newer, what's shinier, more advanced, more powerful. Did you know that every year companies in the US spend over $170 billion on advertising? Advertising that is trying to convince us that what we have isn't enough and that we constantly need more. And don't get me wrong, contentment doesn't mean I'm not allowed to have nice things. I'm not allowed to set dreams, set goals, and succeed. It doesn't mean any of that. It just means that you aren't going to let your desire for those things consume you, become the driving force of your life, or become your identity. It means that you can have a peace of mind, a mental and emotional satisfaction, regardless of the situation you're in. That the crazy circumstances in life will not rob you of your confidence, that God is at work even when you can't sense it. So, how do we open the door to contentment in my life? Let's read another portion of Paul's letter to the Philippians. This is chapter 4, verses 6 through 7. It reads this: "Don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. Tell God what you need and thank him for all he has done. Then you will experience God's peace, which exceeds anything we can understand. His peace will guard your hearts and minds as you live in Christ Jesus." Opening the door to contentment starts with four key things. Write this down: worry less. Let's turn our worry into worship. The next time we're worried about something, let's remind ourselves who God is, what he claims over our life, and who he says we are. He is in control, and he doesn't give us a spirit of worry. Let's not let our worries rob us of our contentment. We gotta worship more and worry less. Next step in opening the door to contentment is we gotta pray more. I think sometimes we forget the magnitude of what we're actually doing when we pray. We're literally talking to the God of the universe who declared over our lives that we're worth dying for. And he cares enough to be in communion with us, like listening to us and talking with us. Like, think about that. That's insane. This mindset that we're actually getting to do when we pray changes the way I pray. And this is a key to opening up the door to contentment. We gotta pray more. Next is we gotta be thankful. One thing I love about Paul is that in most of his letters, before he says anything else, any other instruction or charge to these churches, he starts off by saying, "Hey, I praise God for you." The opening lines of this letter to the Philippians starts with him saying that anytime he thinks of them, he thanks God for them. I don't know about you, but I'm thankful for a lot of things in my life, a lot of people, a lot of blessings in my life that God's given me, but I often fail to stop and thank God for them. This simple practice is a key to opening the door to contentment. And the last key is to focus on Jesus. When we fix our eyes on Jesus, the first three keys we just talked about become so much easier to do. But I know what you might be thinking. Jason, I get it, but those keys to opening the door to contentment sound a lot easier than they actually are when life actually happens to us. And I completely agree. While these four keys indeed open the door to contentment, there are many things that tend to slam it shut in our lives. Write these four contentment killers down. First one is complaining. Here are a few things that happen when we complain. Our bodies release a stress hormone, so we're more likely to be stressed more often. And frequent complaining impairs your immune system and makes you more susceptible to high cholesterol, diabetes, and heart disease. Not the best news. When we complain, we start to stress and we remove ourselves from a posture of contentment. And we just go straight into a state of ungratefulness. It slams the door shut on contentment. The next contentment killer is consuming. Too many Christians today have fallen into this trap of seeing Christianity as just a brand that we consume. When we do this, we're setting ourselves up to have an identity crisis as we live a very frustrated faith journey. We no longer receive the truth of the gospel of what Jesus claims over our lives as our identity. Instead, we get our worth and our value and our identity through other things and other brands that we consume. And this just slams a door shut on contentment. These last two contentment killers sort of go together. Write these down. They're competing and comparing. I have four other siblings and we're all super close. We love spending time together. We love celebrating one another. So we go big on birthdays. And every year for my mom's birthday, each of us think of the best, most meaningful, most thoughtful gifts that we can possibly give her. I remember one year I spent so much time picking out my mom's gift and I was positive that this was the best gift in the world. She's gonna cry when she opens this. It's gonna be great. Well, I give her my gift. She loves it. But immediately after my older sister gives my mom her gift, my mom starts sobbing. As soon as that happened, what did I do? I start thinking, I knew I should have gone with something handmade. And I go right into competing and comparing mode. And in reality, my mom loved my gift. It was never a contest for her, it was only a contest for me. She wasn't comparing my gift with my sister's, I was. And honestly, it kind of killed the special moment for me. The famous author C.S. Lewis once said, "Comparison is the thief of joy." And I experienced that firsthand on my mom's birthday. Remember, the fastest way to kill something special is to compare it to something else. Where competing and comparing begins, contentment ends. I don't know what situation you're in. I don't know the circumstances that you might be facing. But what I do know is this: God's love and grace is greater still. And because of that fact, through Christ, we're able to turn our worry into worship. We're able to be in constant communion with the God of the universe through prayer. That we have so much to be thankful for and praise God for in our life as we take the focus off ourselves and put it on Jesus. We have the true keys to the door of contentment. Here's your thought for the week. Don't let my circumstances determine my contentment. Hey, I praise God for you. We'll see you next week.
Don't let our circumstances determine our contentment. Man, what a timely reminder for all of us, because we're living in a time when our circumstances in a lot of ways seem a little bit less than ideal. We're not just talking here in Orange County or even Southern California. We're talking about our country, even our whole world right now. Things feel a little bit chaotic, maybe a little bit even out of control. But what a good and important reminder for us that, man, as Christians, our contentment shouldn't be determined by our circumstances. You know, just last month, I got to travel to Rwanda, this tiny country in East Africa. And I got to go with a team of junior high and high school students from our church. And while we were there, we got to see so many really in-person, tangible examples of people who have learned how to be content and to have joy in life, no matter what their circumstances are. You know, I got to sit in these tiny little houses, literally made out of mud. Mud walls, dirt floors, no electricity, no running water, no plumbing, let alone toilet paper. And yet these people had learned how to be content in life. They had this joy, no matter what their circumstances. Even though I thought that their circumstances seemed pretty awful, these people lived with the kind of joy that came from something else, because they knew that their contentment comes from their trust in Jesus. They trusted that they have a God who loves them and is gonna take care of them. And what I found is it's really hard for me to worry about my circumstances when I'm around people like that. And I actually think you and I, we've been given a really cool opportunity right now, because as Christians, as followers of Jesus, we have an opportunity to show our neighbors who might not know Jesus yet what it looks like to be content even when our circumstances feel less than ideal, feel a little bit crazy, feel a little bit out of control and chaotic. Man, we can show them that we don't have to be fearful. We don't have to live in fear, but we can trust that God is in control of our lives. He's in control of our world, even when it seems like he's not. And I know that it seems like everything around us is getting postponed or canceled right now, right? Sports, events, school, not quite yet, maybe hopefully soon. But it seems like everything's getting canceled, but make no mistake, the church will never be canceled. Because like we said, the church is not a building, the church is a people, it's a family. And you better believe that this family, we're gonna still be doing what we do best in this time, right? We're still going to be loving God with everything that we've got. We're still gonna be loving everybody around us. In fact, we're gonna crank it up a notch, because it's in times like these that, man, we need to be making the name of Jesus as loud as we possibly can, because there's a lot of people who need to hear it, right? And so don't make the mistake of thinking that just because we're not physically together right now that we can kind of take a break from church. No way, man. There's too many fearful people right now who need to find peace. There are too many hopeless and hurting people right now who need to find some hope. There are too many lost people who need to find Jesus. And we can be the church. And so before we wrap up today, we're gonna spend just a moment and we're gonna pray together. And like we said, even though we're not physically together, we can still unite together in prayer through talking to God. And so AJ's gonna come and he's gonna lead us through that prayer time.
Let's pray together. God, we love you and God, we trust you. I pray that, Lord, we would find our contentment in you and only you during this next season and throughout the rest of our lives, Lord. And God, you are the hope of the world, and we believe that and we trust that, Lord. And I pray that we would just put all of our hope, all of our trust in you right now, God. With the uncertainty in our world, Lord, I pray that we can just rely on you and lean on you and know that you are good and that you have a plan for us, God. Lord, I pray for our communities, I pray for our country, I pray for our world, that you would just be drawing near to people, that people would be coming to know you because you are so good and you are so faithful and you are the one person that we can rely on and that we can trust. So Jesus, we love you and we trust you and we just ask that you continue to move in our lives and let us continue to find our contentment in you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Hey, well, it's so good to do church together with you today. And before we kind of leave, we want to just give you a couple ways where you can stay connected and encouraged during this time.
Hey, the first one of those things is follow us on social media, follow us on YouTube. We're going to be following up all week with some devotionals, with some great ways to stay encouraged throughout the week. So stay tuned on YouTube and on Instagram. And second, get together with some friends this week. Find ways to be the church. Find ways to serve and to love people in your community because that is what God is calling us to during this next season.
Yeah, we love you guys a lot, HSM, JHM, and we hope to see you very soon.
See you guys.